Welcome everyone to the second of 5 webinars in our anaerobic digestion webinar series, Emerging Technologies to Improve Environmental and Economic Impact. This series is hosted by the Center for Sustaining Agriculture and Natural Resources at Washington State University in partnership with the Water Environment Research Foundation and the American Biogas Council. Funding was provided in part by the National Institute of Food and Agriculture at the U.S. Department of Agriculture and by the Environmental Protection Agency. My name is Sonia Hall and I will be moderating this webinar. Before we get started, I'd like to go over a few housekeeping items. First, the webinar will work best on your computer if you close out of any other applications while you participate. Throughout the presentation, all participants will remain muted. We will be holding questions until the end of the presentation. However, you may ask your questions at any time by typing them into the questions pod in your control panel, and we'll just answer them as time allows at the end. If you cannot see your control panel, the orange arrow on the top right of your screen will expand it or hide it, depending on what you want to do. There is also a screen button that toggles the full screen on and off. And so you may want to watch the presentation in full screen and then toggle back to enter a question in the questions pod. If you have any technical questions, please use that same question pod, and my colleague Tara Zimmerman, who is running the technical side of the webinar, will do what she can to assist you. Our webinar today is being recorded for later viewing, and it will be freely available on CSANR's website, and we will give you the link before the end of the presentation. And then finally, following the presentation, there will be a brief electronic evaluation. We ask that you please take a moment to provide your feedback, as that is very helpful to us in improving our webinar offerings moving forward. I'd like to now introduce our webinar co-hosts, who will briefly share their perspective on this webinar series. First off is Barbara Schwartz, Multimedia Production Director with the Water Environment Research Foundation. Barbara, go ahead.
Thank you, Sonia. The Water Environment Research Foundation is an independent scientific research organization that focuses on our water resources. WERF operates with funding from subscribers and grants from the federal government. WERF represents a wide spectrum of the water sector and stresses collaboration among teams of water resource professionals. With funding from a U.S. EPA STAR grant, WERF established the National Research Center for Resource Recovery and Nutrient Management. The center's goal is to provide innovative data, demonstrations, and tools to use valuable resources and waste such as food and manure to form an integral part of a sustainable managed system that includes the nutrients, energy, and water. Anaerobic digestion and the enhancement of the process to generate renewable resources such as biogas for energy recovery from waste is a major focus of WERF's energy research program. As part of this focus, WERF's National Research Center for Resource Recovery is sponsoring research at Washington State University to integrate nutrient recovery and aerobic digestion advances. Our goal for these web seminars is to help share information about the important advances in the technology. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. I'd also like to introduce Caroline Pete, Project Assistant with the American Biogas Council. Caroline, go ahead.
Thank you, Sonia. The American Biogas Council is thrilled to be a partner with WSU and our co-partners to put on this webinar series. Across the biogas industry, as our members try to develop new biogas systems, in nearly every corner we see a lack of education and awareness about the great things biogas systems can provide all of us, economically and environmentally. Collectively, we have a lot of work to do to raise awareness of what biogas systems can do to create non-stop, reliable, 24/7 renewable electricity, heat, and fuels, and create nutrient-rich soil amendments, while also providing systems that allow us to manage organic materials, which make up about one-third of our garbage, as much as glass, metal, paper, and plastics combined, and also allow us to recycle nutrients so we don't have to import phosphorus or fossil fuels to make nitrogen for the fertilizers that our agriculture industry needs. The more people that understand these basic benefits and the multitude of secondary and tertiary benefits that come along with biogas systems, the more successful we'll all be. Plus, there's a ton of work underway at the R&D level to help optimize biogas systems and find new ways to utilize them, and most folks don't know much about that either. That's why we're so happy to be a partner on this webinar series and hope you'll register for all of them. In addition to these webinars, the American Biogas Council also puts on other webinars. If you'd like to know more about them and to receive a notice when we schedule new ones, please go to our website, AmericanBiogasCouncil.org, and click on the big red free biogas news sign-up button to share your contact information with us. Of course, we hope you'll also check out becoming a member of the ABC so you can get access to even more market intelligence, insider info and on state and federal biogas policy, and contact information for the 200 companies and almost 10,000 individuals in our biogas stakeholder network. Thank you.
Thank you, Caroline. Now I'd like to present today's speaker. Dr. Manuel Garcia-Perez will discuss the potential for biochar production and utilization within an anaerobic digestion biorefinery. Dr. Garcia-Perez is an associate professor in the Department of Biological Systems Engineering at Washington State University, and for the last 15 years has been working on projects related to the conversion of forest and agricultural biomass into biofuels and chemicals, mostly via thermochemical conversion. Dr. Garcia-Perez is also very active in the study of ways to integrate biomass conversion technologies into existing infrastructure to build biorefineries that produce fuel and chemicals. Without further ado, I will hand it over to Dr. Manuel Garcia-Perez.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation to speak in this webinar, and I would like to thank the organizer for this opportunity and also my students and collaborators that are the ones that have been generating the data I'm going to present today. So my talk today will be about the potential for biomass biochar production and utilization in anaerobic digestion biorefineries. So let's start my presentation with a brief introduction of what is a biorefinery. There are many concepts of what a biorefinery is, but I would like to focus on the general concept that says that a biorefinery is a facility that integrates biomass conversion processes and equipment to produce fuels, power, and value-added chemicals from biomass. The biorefinery concept is analogous to today's petroleum refinery, which produces multiple fuels and products from petroleum. So what we are going to do in today's webinar is actually to see how this concept can be implemented or used in improving or advancing anaerobic digestion technologies. Now, what are the key ingredients that we need to build a biorefinery? Well, we need to be thinking about integration of emerging and existing technologies. We need to be thinking about new products from waste streams, processing new feedstock, developing high-value products from existing products. We need to be thinking about taking advantage of the economies of scale, synergies with existing infrastructure, the concept of evolution, so the gradual addition of technologies and the gradual improvement, not all at once. We need to, of course, we need to try to avoid products directly competing with petroleum because this is a very strong competition, and we need to be thinking about possibilities to improve the environmental, social, and economic sustainability of these systems. Let's start talking about the small, what we may call first-generation anaerobic digestion systems. Those are systems that are used in small farms or even in many developing nations. And if those systems actually, because of the size and the scale, impose some limitations of what technologies you may be using there. So in our group, many years ago, we proposed this concept by which you can have mobile units, and those mobile units can actually go to the anaerobic digestion lagoons, and we may be cleaning this water. At the same time, Professor Greg Moller from the University of Idaho has been working very diligently and advancing this his own concept. In his case, basically, he's using a similar mobile platform, but he's using biochar and iron chloride and ozone in two-step processes to actually clean the effluents of anaerobic digestion. This is an example of a concept for a small system that is uses biochar as one of the ingredients in the process. And I want to compliment the work Professor Greg Moller that has been very instrumental advancing this idea. Here are some pictures of the system, the mobile treatment system that he developed, and testing in the lagoon. When we talk about large anaerobic digestion system, then we have other opportunities to develop new concepts. And here are some of the concepts that have been that Professor Shuring-Chen from WSU has been proposing. The idea is basically you have an anaerobic digestion system, and you can basically, using those ideas, you can start using new feedstock. You can, for example, food waste. We can actually use lignocellulosic material pretreated. We can develop new technologies for gas cleaning, developing new products from the effluent. The reality is, the possibilities are endless, but what today I want to talk is about the potential for integration on anaerobic digestion of slow pyrolysis. So slow pyrolysis is a technology that allows us to, you get a biomass, and as a result of the biomass, you get a char, a carbonaceous product, and you get volatiles that are combusted in a thermal oxide acid to get a heat. It can be in the form of steam or air. So how can we integrate this technology with anaerobic digestion? This is just one potential integration scheme, and I want all of you to understand that. There are many more potential integration schemes, and of course, this is an area of active investigation, but the one I'm going to talk today is about this. This is not the best, but this is the one we are working with. So the idea is to get solid from anaerobic digestion, we go to pyrolysis, we get a char, and then we are going to engineer that char. In this case, we're talking about oxidation, so it can be used to clean our effluents, and our vapor would be to produce a heat, and the char would also be used as you can also be used, as you will see, for cleaning of the biogas that is produced. Now, of course, our program at Washington State University has been building capabilities and capacity to be able to address some of the challenges, the research challenges of this. And I want you to notice that we need to move from a more fundamental studies where we try to understand the relationship of biomass composition and the processing condition. When we engineer biochar, we need to move from that status to develop and validate the products, going to larger scale testing, field testing, and commercialization. And we are basically at this stage, we're really in this first stage in many of the technologies we're working. And what I want you to notice that as we move forward, certainly the social impact increase, the research and development costs augment, the capacity to train students and publish peer-reviewed journals decreases. So we only have to be, is this balance between the impact and the limitation of funding and how much can we advance. But certainly this is what needs to be done to actually have an impact in this field. Of course, we have laboratory installation, we have some bench scale, and we are trying to get this large-scale unit to produce large quantities of charcoal, and we have been growing analytical capabilities to analyze those materials. One of the work that we do at Washington State University that we're very proud of is trying to develop new methods to characterize these chars, which is said that the method that has been developed for the characterization of some of the carbonaceous material, like let's say carbon black or carbon fibers, are not directly applicable to characterization of biochar. So a huge amount of work has to be done in adapting those methods for biochar characterization. This is what we have been doing. We have been developing new strategies for Raman, for the initial spectra for Raman, carbon 13, XPS, that are resulted in publications in this in this area. Now, let's going to see a little bit, to talk a little bit about what happens when you produce biochar. So as you increase, if you produce a temperature, the biochar at low temperature, you typically will have a carbonaceous material with around 65 to 70% of carbon. As you increase the temperature, the carbon content will increase. The oxygen content, the hydrogen content of your material decrease dramatically. And the nitrogen content typically remain the same. If you see the material, the biochar, with SEM, scanning electron microscopy, you're going to see these structures, which are basically the same structure that you have in the biomass and where the dead cells, but they really don't contribute a lot to surface area. Most of the surface area which you are interested in is basically the surface on the surface of this, on the surface. And this is what you can see here with TEM, a transmission electron microscopy, and you can see here a char 450, a char produced at 650, and you see how more holes appears on the surface of the char, which are in the range of the nanometer range, and those are really the holes that we need to, it's there in these holes where the absorption, most of the absorption process will happen. If, for example, we're talking about gas absorption. If we're talking, for example, water holding capacity, then the Lohmann structure is very important, and the charge of the surface is very important. For example, with interaction of with colloidal system with microbial system. So I want you to understand that everything is the performance of the char is actually determined by these structures at the nano level. If you, as you can see here, as we increase the pyrolysis temperature, the surface area of our biochar, this is without chemical or physical activation, can go up to 500 meters squared per gram. But those are determined by carbon dioxide absorption. If you do nitrogen absorption, you actually measure, you don't measure area at temperature below 500 degrees Celsius, and it's mostly because the pore size are very, very small, are in the micro range below 2 nanometers that are very difficult to measure by nitrogen adsorption. So yes, as you increase the temperature, you start to form surface area, but that surface area is in very, very small pores that may not be the size that you need for the adsorption of the compound that you're interested in your system. The surface functionalities, you start to lose, as you lose oxygen, you also lose functionalities on your surface, but the ash content increases, so the content of ash and consequently the basic functional group on your biochar also increase. So the biochar produced at high temperature will have more ash, will tend to be more basic, but the biochar produced at low temperature will tend to have more functional group on the surface with much less surface area. Now, it has an influence on the surface charge of your biochar. The biochar that are produced at lower temperature will tend to be charged more negatively. Biochars produced at high temperature will tend to be charged more positively. And it has a huge impact on the electrostatic interaction between the char, for example, like colloidal particles and the microorganisms. The cation change capacity doesn't change much, just with the influence of the temperature. And the reason is because it's true that you're losing functional groups, but you're creating more surface area in your material. Now, because of the alkalines are increasing, and this is what you can see in this figure, the increase on the alkaline and the metals and the alkalines and alkaline earth that you have in your material, also the pH and the electric conductivity of your char tend to increase, mostly because of the presence, because of the concentration of those materials in your biochar. Now, this is just production of biochar, but it's very clear that pyrolysis is not enough to get a material that have a performance in one of the applications that we are seeking. So we have been, initially we were very interested to try to oxidize the surface of the biochar. We know high temperature, you basically lose functionality. We want to have big surface area and big functionality. So we have been working on oxidation by two methods, ozonation and also air oxidation. Ozonation is good because you can do that at low temperature. It's actually a problem because oxygenation of ozone is expensive. As you can see here, as we increase ozonation time, we are increasing the cation exchange capacity of our material. And it was one of the problems that we wanted to increase because we wanted to remove ammonium from solution. And it's also very important because if later we want to use the biochar as a soil amendment, the cation exchange capacity is very important to increase the fertility of soils, particularly soil that has very low carbon content. As we can see, there's a direct relationship between the formation of carboxyl functional group on the surface and the increase in cation exchange capacity. We see that there is very little change in surface area, but yes, when we try to oxidize the biochar, the temperature of the biochar tends to increase, and if, because there's some oxidation, if that happens, then instead of carboxylic functional group, we will start to form lactonic functional group. When we do oxidation in air at 225 degrees Celsius, we see that the biochars produced at low temperature are more easy to oxidize than the biochar. This is the content of total acidic functional group. The low temperature biochar are more easy to oxidize than the high temperature biochar. In all the cases, we see an increase in the presence of acidic functional group, and we see an increase with them of the kind of amount of ammonium that we can recover from solution. Now, when we try to do that with actual effluents, we didn't see this effect, and the main reason for that is because in the actual effluent, there is competition with cations, with, let's say, with other ions, or cations that actually will be more likely to be absorbed or will be to be exchanged in the carboxyl functional group on the surface. So what we're trying to do right now is actually to study the potential to devolatilize this ammonium and try to absorb them in vapor phase or in vapor phase or after condensation from vapor phase in it, so that we don't have this competition with the cations. We observed some, in the case of some biochar, we observed an increase in absorption of ammonium, but that was not the case in all the biochar. So we are not proposing at this stage more research need to be done on the potential of oxidative biochar for ammonia reduction. We believe in aqueous phase, we find that it is not working very well. We're going to do that in vapor phase. Now, the removal of phosphates is also an area of major interest, and this work was started by Hal Collins and Estrubel as part of this thesis. And what they did basically, they got an aerobic digestive fiber, they pyrolyze in a very rudimentary kiln, they get their char, and then they added their char to effluents, to anaerobic digestion effluents, to see if they were able to reduce their phosphorus content. And what they observed is that certainly the phosphorus content reduced from more than 400 milligrams per liter to approximately half, less than half that quantity. And in so the addition of biochar allowed them to reduce, when they observed their biochar, this is the initial biochar, and the biochar after a lagoon treatment, they observed coatings on the surface, so most likely the colloidal biochar, the colloidal phosphorus, sorry, was absorbed. And this process has not been well studied, but it's mostly, this should be controlled by the surface charge of the biochar. So this is something that needs to be studied more in the detail in the future, but we believe that the result of Collins and Estrubel are mostly because of electrostatic interaction with the colloidal phosphorus. So we tried at WSU to develop biochars that were able to also eliminate or remove the phosphorus that is not in the colloidal phosphorus, but is solubilized phosphorus. And in that, we tried to precipitate calcium chloride in biochar by changing the pH on the solution. And we get these biochars with a calcium chloride precipitated on the surface. When we did our studies, we clearly see that as we change the pH, we increase the concentration of calcium on the surface of the biochar, of the fiber, and then we see also an increase in the amount of char that was produced as we have more calcium. And we know that calcium is a catalyst for cross-linking, so it enhances carbon charcoal production. Depending on the pH at which the fiber was produced, we see that as we increase the pH and consequently the carbon, the calcium, we see an increase in absorption of phosphorus, and this is mostly because of the phosphorus in colloidal, in solution, sorry. This is some phosphorus in solution. And we see clearly here a direct relationship between the calcium and magnesium concentration on the surface and the equilibrium phosphorus that has been absorbed in the surface of the biochar. Have been precipitated. In this case, it has been precipitated. Now, the work of Greg Muller with his mobile system is also very remarkable. What they did is they did studies only adding ozone, and they did studies also with ozone and iron, and they also with ozone and biochar. And what they observed clearly is they observed that as we add ozone, iron, and biochar, they see a reduction both in the particulate phosphorus and in the dissolved reactive phosphorus. And now more so is needed to try to understand the mechanism by which it is happening. We are also very interested in the use of biochar for the removal of E. coli. In this case, we study this study that was done with Professor Nehal from Chemical Engineering, and we studied a pathogenic E. coli and a non-pathogenic E. coli, and we observed that biochar was particularly good at the removal of the pathogenic E. coli. It is mostly related. Here you also see this is the concentration versus time absorption, and we see, for example, that the biochar that was without oxidation was much better to absorb E. coli, the pathogenic E. coli, that the biochar with oxidation, and this is all related to the fact that the oxidized biochar will tend to have more negative charge on the surface that the biochar that's used, the actual raw biochar. So because the pathogenic E. coli is very negatively charged, they will repel, so the absorption and the removal of E. coli will be very poor. So we believe that we have the developing biochar that are positively charged is actually a very interesting way for the removal of E. coli. And here you can see the relationship between the char percentage and the removal of the pathogenic and non-pathogenic. And again, the difference is mostly because the pathogenic was a very negatively charged chart. Now, the group of professors, Dr. Craig Fleer, also did some studies on the potential of biochar for anaerobic digestion for the removal of H2S. This is the H2S in the biogas. His group did some studies with biochar produced at low temperature, and this is the breakthrough curve of the H2S, and you can see the activated carbon lasts much longer than the biochar that we produce, but as soon as we increase the temperature of the biochar, and more importantly, when we add a sodium carbonate, we were able to produce a biochar with much higher capacity to retain H2S, and we are currently studying on other potential modifications of the biochar. This is a study that we did in our, that they did in our lab. Those are the biochar columns, and this is the GC. So basically, we bubble model biogas with H2S, and we actually measure the H2S at the inlet and outlet of the column, and we can see the biochar that has been the removal of the H2S from that. As a conclusion, I think we are working in the development of many type of biochar for applications that are relevant for anaerobic digestion, and we can say that the development of engineered biochar for the removal of nutrients in anaerobic digestion is an important task, or for the cleaning of syngas, is an important task to create and deploy novel anaerobic digestion biorefineries. Oxidation by ozone and air can both effectively increase cation exchange capacity, however, this mechanism is not effective for removing ammonia in solution. We'll try to remove, but it results in the biochar that has most better prospect to be used as a soil amendment. Alkaline metal on the surface, on fiber surface, after pyrolysis generate basic sites that are useful for the removal of phosphate from solution. Biochar with positive charge are needed for the removal of E. coli. So if you want to clean effluents from E. coli, biochar that are positive charge can be used for that. High surface area biochar are produced at very high temperature or through physical and chemical activation. And these biochars, or biochar with certain metals on the surface, are critical for the removal of H2S from biogas. Biochar modifications show promise for use as a solvent for wastewater, but sites can be rapidly blocked by suspended and corroded soils in undertreated effluent. So you cannot use biochar directly in system that has colloidal, so it has to be used as part of a strategy for cleaning. So you have to take care first of the suspended material, or you have to design a biochar for this kind of thing, and you have to gradually be eliminating the pollutant. So a sequential batch of filters, a biochar with high cation exchange capacity, doped with calcium and phosphorus and so on, are needed to make a good cleaning of the effluent. So it's not, it has to be correctly sought before we can actually use it. I would like to thank the funding agencies, but especially the Washington State Department of Agriculture and Appendix A, USDA, the Washington State Department of Ecology that has been partners in this for many years on this research. And I want to thank all of you for today, presence, for coming to this webinar. I would be more than happy to answer your question. Please, if you want to see our webinar, you can go to this link, or you can send me emails for more specific questions in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Manuel. We do already have a few questions coming in. To all participants, please submit any additional questions to Manuel through the questions pod. We have a good amount of time for questions, so please submit those as you think of them. The first question, Manuel, is, please describe the pretreatment process for straw as a feedstock for an anaerobic digester. Is there a certain maximum ratio of such treated straw in the full AD feedstock?
Okay, this is a very good question. I should say that the expert in this area is our colleague Chulin Chen. He has been working in the development of pretreatment technologies, and I cannot answer with specifics. But on this, but basically the critical issue here is how to release the sugars that are in the hemicellulose and the cellulose part. You know, the lignin is much more difficult to digest because they are phenols. So I cannot give you details, but I really strongly recommend you to contact Chulin Chen, Professor Chulin Chen from Washington State University, with this specific question and with more elements. For details. Again, this is a work that is being done in our department, but I'm not doing this work myself.
Thank you. The next question is, are you or any of your colleagues doing similar work with hydrochar from hydrothermal carbonization?
Yes, again, what I presented today is our view of pyrolysis. There's no reason why hydrothermal carbonization could not work. In fact, I didn't present in this webinar, but we are also interested on the potential co-anaerobic digestion of pyrolysis products, for example, acetic acid or other pyrolysis products in that. We also believe that there are potentials for the co-anaerobic digestion of the aqueous effluents for hydrothermal liquefaction. So certainly, we see potential in that regard, but in today's webinar, I focus only on pyrolysis, but the same could be said on hydrothermal liquefaction. In fact, I see clear possibilities of integration because of you have a lot of material in an aqueous phase that could be co-digested. There will be problems because you also produce some toxic compounds, but certainly the biochar produced with hydrothermal processes could also be used in the same application. Of course, we will have to see the surface area. We may need to modify the surface chemistry, but I don't see a priori any reason why it will not be usable.
Thank you, Manuel. Another question that has come in, can you explain the source of the biochar?
Well, in the job that we presented, there are different sources, of course. In part of the work that you thought was done actually anaerobic digestive fibers for actual anaerobic digesters, most of the fundamental work has been done with actually a little bit more cleaner biomass like pine gut, straw, Douglas fir, a hybrid poplar. But as you could see, the work with Dr. Collins was anaerobic digestive fibers. Some of the work for H2S removal has been also done with anaerobic digestive fiber. Also, some of the work for nitrogen and phosphorus removal in our has been done with anaerobic digestive fiber. So, if you want specific of each, I can go back to the presentation. But we have been using a broad range of feedstocks. But whenever possible, we try to use anaerobic digestive fiber for actual application. For fundamental studies, we tend to use a cleaner biomass because it allows us to see more clearly what are the effects of the parameters.
Thank you, Manuel. The next question is there a clearinghouse of information on various biochar's use for different soil and farming conditions? Where could we look for agricultural applications information?
Yes, this is a very interesting and well. There have been a huge movement on trying to develop biochar for soil application. And in fact, it has been the case that in some cases where you use the biochar in certain soils, it works very well. In other soils, it doesn't work very well. So now the community is moving toward understanding why, trying to match biochar with soil to see what kind of biomass would be good for certain soil, how it helps. And of course, from the point of view of the conversion people, our job is to try to create a functionality that will actually generate the desired effect on the soil. For example, if you want to hold water, if your problem with your soil is water holding capacity, most likely you want a char that is able to hold a lot of water. That is basically capillary hold in the lumen, and also you need a surface that is polar so that it's not hydrophobic. So, for example, this is a case. If you want, for example, if you have a soil that has very little material, organic content, for example, and has very little cationic chest capacity, you may want a biochar with very high cationic chest capacity, like the one we talked before. If you, for example, want a biochar, if you have a soil that is, for example, acidic, you may be thinking on a biochar or taking advantage of the ash, which are the one that give the alkalinity to the biochar. So to summarize and to answer your question, I don't know a single place where you can actually see a library. I think we are in our infancy on it. I think my current understanding of it is that we are actually advancing our understanding. For example, the relationship between biochar and a microorganism is still in its infancy. But what I think is there are evidences that it works. Now the question, now we are advanced to understand why it works in certain cases, and then the next step is how can we design a biochar that maximizes the potential. I think this is something that we will be doing perhaps in the next 5 years. So it is really an area in its infancy, and we are going to see growth in knowledge. The International Biochar Initiative has been a wonderful initiative. I think it's perhaps the best. There are a number of books that have been published. For example, Professor Johannes Lehmann published a book, the new version of the book, of his biochar book, which I think is a great source. But we are still advancing in the field. This is the reality on this. We are still advancing in the field.
Thank you, Manuel. What do you propose to use the biochar for after treatment?
Well, I think it depends on the biochar that you have. If you have a biochar that is very rich, for example, it's in sulfur, it may be a good fertilizer. I certainly believe that the best way because most of these applications are for holding nutrients, and the nutrients are fertilizers, I think there will be a very good soil amendments. That's what we have been thinking all over. But first, we need to generate the knowledge base to, first of all, improve the technologies that we're working right now so that the biochar actually has the content of the nutrients, and then we need to test. And this is the next seminar. The next webinar is from Dr. Hal Collins, that he's going to be presenting some of his results on the use of some of these materials, not necessarily all the ones that I talked about today, but materials that have been generated from anaerobic digestion. So this is an area of research, and again, we have people working like Dr. Collins on this area.
Thank you, Manuel. The next question is, can biochar be a replacement for activated carbon made from traditional carbon black?
Yes, it can. I think the important thing to remember from activated carbon is that it is a material that has a high surface area. It has been produced either by physical or chemical activation, and it typically has to be produced from a feedstock, let's say coconut shell, palm oil shell, that is very rich in lignin. Otherwise, when you try to open this amount of holes on the surface, you're going, the other materials tend to disintegrate. So you cannot get this high surface area or high mesoporous contents with material that doesn't have the strength to survive, to keep these volumes of empty holes inside. Biochar can and could be a replacement or a source. I think we should be aware that the performance should always be will be lower, but if you can develop a material, so let's put it in this way: the biggest advantage of activated carbon is a higher performance, but its cost is very high. So in application where you don't need to regenerate, particularly in environmental services, I think biochar will actually be the leading candidate because it's cheaper. You can actually use any waste material that you have, even if it has high ash contents or low, or this material that has nitrogen that you may not use for activated carbon production. So you will have a material which will have less performance, but we actually will be much cheaper, and will actually give an acceptable, will give you acceptable environmental services, and will actually give you a good carbon sequestration tool at relatively low cost. So I think it's there where we want to go. Inevitably, if you want to get the same performance of an activated carbon, you need to have a feedstock that has similar characteristics to what has been used today, like coal base or coconut shell base, and those materials have, or other materials that have high lignin content.
Manuel, the next question is actually very timely. It's a follow-up. How does engineered biochar production compare in complexity and capital cost to the production of activated carbon for high selective absorption of nutrients and metals?
Yeah, activated carbon basically is a product that in most of the cases is based on high surface area, and you have two activation strategies that you have to use there. One activation strategy is called chemical activation, where you add a chemical, typically it's a dehydrating agent. It can be phosphoric acid. It can be other material to your feedstock. And then you heat it. This is what is called chemical activation. And mostly they create micropores. The other activation strategy is called physical activation, where you actually produce your biochar, and then you heat the char that you produce at higher temperature, 800 degrees Celsius, in the presence of an oxidizing agent, typically steam or CO2, and then you start to open holes. The great potential of activated carbon is that you basically have a lot of surface area. And it's typically, in most of the cases, used for physical absorption, and there is a component which is the regeneration. So you typically have a product that you're going to regenerate, and you take advantage of the physical activation. And again, the critical issue here is you are limited to certain type of materials. So coconut shell, palm oil shell, some coal-based product or petroleum-based product that give you that strength. In the case of the biochar, you only heat the biochar, you get a material with certain surface area, and then the question is, can I have a material that is able to absorb enough quantity of your pollutant, and then can be discharged in the soil? For example, what we're planning to do here is basically to get your biochar with your effluents, it get enriched in the nutrient. We are not going to regenerate it. We're going to put into the soil. We add certain value of the nutrient. Hopefully, it will pay off on the increment. So it would certainly, when you compare, and our goal is to have a material that has, let's say, that would be able to sell by $200 per ton or less, which the biochars are basically in the $1,000 per ton. That's actually the real goal here. And you can use, the goal here is, what can I do with the waste material that I have, which in this case is the fiber? Can I get something that can give me an environmental performance that is good enough to justify its application? This is, I see this as a philosophy here. It will never be this super absorbent. For example, I mean, we are very surprised to see that it's actually outperforming better than activated carbon when we do H2S removal. But we should not be surprised if it doesn't perform as well, because you didn't start with this butyl feedstock, which is actually the critical element to produce activated carbon. You have to start with butyl feedstock. Not sure if I answered the question, but this is where I see the biochar playing a role in environmental services, where cost is important, regeneration of the material is not, and I think we have the opportunity to take more advantage of chemical absorption, whether in activated carbon, typically we take advantage of physical absorption because we want to regenerate the material. Those are, I think, the opportunities for biochar.
Thank you, Manuel. The next question is, I have used sawdust biochar and biochar made from raw dry dairy manure. Both were pyrolyzed at 500 degrees Celsius and had very low cation exchange capacity. Can you suggest post-pyrolysis treatments that would improve the cation exchange capacity of these materials?
Yeah, I think the cation exchange capacity is just a function of the carboxylic functional group on the surface. What we have been doing is, if you have your material and it's already cold, for example, that you bought that from somewhere and you don't have the system operating, perhaps in that case I will say, well, you do an ozonation to your material with certain time, and in that case you're going to create acidic functional group that will enhance your cation exchange capacity. If on the other hand, you have a system that's on production, I think you can actually try to oxidize it while you're cooling your char. Now, I want you to notice, and this is very, very important, that when you do that, please check that you're not generating that. You're not, when you try to oxidize, another potential effect is that you may be actually breaking some of the aromatic system. The polyaromatic system may be released from the polyaromatic structure. So before you do any practical thing with your char, you need to check that during the oxidation process, you didn't release any structure that is potentially soluble into your liquid. So my recommendation, well, you can also do some acid treatment to oxidize, and those are very well known oxidation strategies. But in any case, when you oxidize the biochar, particularly low temperature biochar, that are the structures are not very strong, you may cleavage some of these polyaromatic structures that may become leachable. So be very careful when you do that. And if you see that when you put your material, then you start to get a black, then you don't use that biochar because you're producing polyaromatic systems out of it. So other oxidation strategy would be acid, with acid, strong acids.
Thank you, Manuel. There are actually a few questions, well, a few comments related to other resources that participants ask that you comment on. The first is an Argonne National Lab published a study last fall reporting that the addition of biochar directly into the AD system improved the quality of the biogas, reaching pipeline quality gas. And the question is, are you familiar with that work? And if you have any comments, another reference provided from UC Davis has a biochar database active at biochar.ucdavis.edu. And the third one is a new tech paper from Dr. Pete Smith, Soil Carbon Sequestration and Biochar as Negative Emissions Technologies, that was published this year. It indicates that biochars are incredibly important to reduce greenhouse gas levels. So go ahead, Manuel.
Well, first of all, I think all these are very valuable, and we are very thankful and appreciative that the work that our colleagues, I mean, unfortunately, in a webinar like this, we don't have enough time to acknowledge the work that everybody is doing, and the community is very big. So the fact that I didn't acknowledge or talk about their work doesn't mean that their work is not important. On the contrary, I think both the work doing by Argonne, by UC Davis, and the textbook that has been cited, I think they're good piece of work. I'm not familiar completely with all of them, but let me say the following. Yes, the use of biochar inside an anaerobic digestion system has been studied, and we are aware of that work. We haven't done anything inside. The question that we will ask the authors of that work is, what is the mechanism by which this happened, and then can we enhance that mechanism by modifying the char? That's as a biochar engineer, that's what I will be asking them. I will not question the result. I think there's no reason to question the results. I think the question for me is, how can I improve that result if at all possible? And to do that, I will need, I think in the future, our community will need to understand by which mechanism that improvement in biogas, are we forming biofilms on the biogas? Are they methanogenic bacteria, the acinogenic bacteria populating the biochar, by which form? I mean, those are the kind of questions that we'll be looking at that report of Argonne. I honestly do not have more comments on that, except that I think the fact that it worked, it gives us an idea that it's something that we should explore further. From the scientific point of view and advancing, you need to understand why it worked and then can we do it better. And I think this is very important what they did. The literature review and the brochure from the University of Davis, I mean, wonderful that the fact that I didn't mention it, I think it's needed. If they already have it, I will be very happy if they could send that to me. The same thing is the Argonne report, because I've seen the more systematic we are and the more we are able to develop general rules, the more we're going to advance. I think what we have right now is a lot of success stories, but we need to understand why it happened and then generate the general rules for others, and that we can use that general rule in the design of the material. And the textbook that was cited, this is wonderful. I think we need education in this area. I often say that the people I know with higher social impact are the educators. So I really commend this work of building textbooks for the people to understand the field. So I just can commend that. I think all these actions are needed to advance it. This is really not the work of one group, not the work of one institution. It's really a work of a community of believers, and I think we will always be successful when we appreciate the work of others. That's my view on those reports.
Thank you, Manuel. There is a related comment as well. We do need a comprehensive list of biochars and data, so it sounds like there may be some resources out there, and we'll share those as part of this webinar. The next question
can I say something on that,
yes,
on the need for the comprehensive data? I think what is very important is that our constituency, because in the area of biochar, there has been some funding, and there have been people that have been enthusiastic in the state, even in the federal government, but I think it's very important to understand that there have been a limited amount of funding in this area from certain agencies. So I think in order to do all of this, it's really needed. I think what is important is if the community feels there is a need for something, we need that. It's important that you state that as often as possible so that the people that are in charge of advancing knowledge and advancing realize that there's a real need, and in the eventually funding will come to this area. So I fully agree with you that there is a need to actually do it systematically and to get a lead of performance per biochar. Fully agree with you. And the biochar, International Biochar Initiative is a good venue to say that, but I also thinking on the need to let our federal agency know that there is people that believe that this is an area that needs to be advanced.
Thank you, Manuel. For everyone, if you look in your questions pod, I have shared those three resources that we've been discussing that were brought up by different participants. The next question, Manuel, is the digestate dried before pyrolytic conversion into biochar?
It has to be dry, and it has to be dry because otherwise you use a high temperature energy to dry, which is not the ideal thing. Now, it doesn't have to be dry, completely dry. My recommendation is always try to use energy integration, heat integration, and try to use any excess, a low quality heat that you are released from your system, let's say exhaust gases from your electric generator, whatever source of heat, but if possible, avoid using high temperature heat, because that's actually the heat that you can use for many good things. So yes, it has to be, the moisture content should go less than 10%. I mean, if you have really a very wet material, perhaps hydrothermal liquefaction will be better, but I've seen a fiber with less than 10% is actually fine to be pyrolyzed. You will, again, you're going to consume some energy. The best thing is to use as much as low quality energy at 200 degrees Celsius that for that purposes. So if possible, avoid using natural gas or any fuel, any high quality fuel for the process. I mean, heat integration is critical here.
Thank you. The next question is, many higher efficiency cook stove technologies produce a biochar from their general cooking operations. Are the biochars produced from these small-scale systems reasonably useful?
Yes, we have a paper that is a paper on campfire, teaching the people the fundamental. I mean, there is no, the phenomena that happen when you have a cook stove is the same phenomena that happened when we produce the biochar. The only difference is that in the pyrolysis reactor, and in fact, I strongly believe that you are much better off to use a combustion system to produce biochar than the actual pyrolysis system, because the pyrolysis reactors are really first generation technologies. We're trying to improve them, you can, any carbonaceous material that you get out of a thermochemical system that has removed most of the volatile, it's actually a good precursor to produce engineered biochar. If you continue attacking your biochar, you're going to end up with an ash. And I always tell the people that even in my class, when you are in a campfire, initially you see this white smoke coming out. This is basically steam, water, and then you start to see the flame forming, which is actually the volatiles coming out. When all the volatiles has been removed, you have the biochar, and then the question here is when you start to attack it and it gets red, you start to lose carbonaceous material by oxidation with air, you start to get more ash. If you avoid that final step from happening, you can have a material that has a very high carbon content, as high as you can produce in a pyrolysis reactor. Of course, if you even go even before that and you actually quench it with water, when it's still flame off, you're going to have a material that still have a lot of volatiles, but still the carbon content will be bigger. So this is really a continuum. It's not, this is pyrolysis gasification, it's really a continuum of phenomena that you can manipulate, and this is what engineers do, manipulate it or playing with the phenomena to get a product of the quality you want. But you have to be very careful when you use cooked stover that you don't let it go too far to the point where you basically has ash. That's basically my recommendation, but there's no reason why you cannot use cooked stover.
Thank you. We have time for a few more questions still. The next one is, have you looked at biochar from municipal sewage sludge? Does this behave similarly to the wood and fibers or not?
Yeah, this is a very interesting question. I think the issue with the municipal sewage is the heavy metals that may be there, which actually you can handle that later when you produce the biochar, and the content of proteins and nitrogen. Actually, this would be a very interesting biochar because when you produce, when you use a feedstock-rich in proteins and you do pyrolysis, half of the proteins remain in the char, and you tend to form a char which is positively charged. So the answer to you is your charge will be very different because it has nitrogen on it. Some nitrogen, it is not available, but it actually gives unique properties to the biochar in terms of the charge. It's not, I mean, let's put it in this way, it has not been studied. It's an area that you go to the literature and you're not going to find anything in the literature on that, but this is my expectation that what should happen, and it should be a study. But certainly I believe the biochar would be very interesting. The only drawback I think here is the potential presence of heavy metals, but if you are concerned some of them, you can always leach them out after you produce. You can always wash your biochar to get your metals out before you commercialize it.
Thank you, Manuel. We have time for probably one more question, and that is, I am interested in charging biochar with elements of a living soil, such as calcium, magnesium, potassium, manganese, iron, etc., as individual elements or as compounds for specific custom fertilization. So for example, say a manganese deficient soil, the biochar manganese fertilizer could be used to fix that particular deficiency. Is this possible?
Well, I think it's possible if you understand the mechanism by which the absorption will happen, by which the release will happen. Certainly, I mean, we can be thinking on designing slow release fertilizers. I think from the engineering point of view, it's possible. Now we will have the devil is in the details, and we will need to see okay. How you plan to be absorbing this material, how we're going to do that. Let's put it this way. I cannot tell you, I don't see any reason today to tell you it is not possible, okay? What I feel is that if we think carefully about that, we may be able to do it. I don't find any reason now to tell you it is not possible. Just so potentially, it is potentially possible, but we need to work out on the design and on playing with the phenomena that will make possible that for happening. But so far, I don't see any reason why it may not be possible.
Thank you very much, Manuel. Clearly, there are a lot of questions and a lot of research still to be done. Unfortunately, that is all the time we have today. So I'd like to thank everyone for participating in this webinar and for your engagement through all the questions that you submitted. As you sign off, please take a minute to fill out the evaluation survey and give us feedback on the webinar. Our next webinar is scheduled for March 23rd at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, 10 a.m. Pacific Time. So this is actually almost a month from now. On that webinar, Dr. Harold Collins with the Agricultural Research Service will be discussing agronomic evaluation of anaerobic digestion system recovered fertilizers. So hopefully answering some of the questions that came up today. So please register to join us again on March 23rd. Thank you everyone for participating, and we look forward to seeing you next time.